Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us this week. My name is Beth Gay Freeman, and this is my email. If you'd like to email me about anything, there it is, and please go ahead and do so. I do a little paper. It's called Beth's Newfangled Family Tree, and this is how you can get it on the internet. https://electricscotland.com/BNFT for Beth's Newfangled Family Tree. And guess what? It's free, free, free. No charges, no strings. Okay. We're going to continue today, but first, I've ran across something that describes a real old-timey Scottish wedding, a real one, true one. And they were known as penny weddings, and they were renowned for feasting, drinking, dancing, and fighting. They were enjoyed by all except the clergy, who disapproved of such raucous behavior, opinions that were wholeheartedly ignored. Gifts were made to the newlyweds toward the cost of the wedding feast and the wild celebrations, which started on the eve of the wedding with singing, toasts, and the ceremony of feet washing. A tub of water was placed in the best room of the house, in which the bride placed her feet. Her female friends then gathered around to help wash them. A wedding ring from a happily married woman was previously placed in the tub, and it was believed that whomever found the ring would be next to get married. The menfolk were outside the door, making jokes and attempting to watch through the doorway. The following day, the bridal party made their way to the church, with flower petals being thrown in front of the bride. But if they encountered a funeral or a pig on the way, it was considered bad luck, and they would return home and start all over again. The first person they encountered was called the first foot, and would be given a coin and a drink of whiskey by the bride. He would then have to accompany the bridal party for 1 mile before being allowed to continue on his way. Just outside the church, they would be met by the clergyman and make their wedding vows. Then a mass was held in the church, during which the clergyman blessed the food brought by the guests. And it was traditional also for the clergyman, however shy, to kiss the bride. An old-timey Scottish wedding. We're talking today and finishing up on this, I think. You do speak Gaelic. These are a few southern words taken from a much longer list. How about biddy? What are baby chickens called? Biddies. And it is from bid, bide, and bidage, meaning a small portion of anything, hence a small chicken, a baby chick. Now, did you ever have your grandmama or somebody tell you, now don't you mess up your brogans today while you're at school? That meant shoes. It was a word for high-topped shoes, and it is pure Gaelic, and it is pronounced in the Gaelic, brogan, which is the plural form of brog, meaning shoe. Now, I used to taunt my younger brothers when he got mad at me by saying, go ahead then, stick out your boose. The Gaelic word bus, and it is pronounced boose, means lips or snout, such as a pig's snout. The same word in French is spelled B-O-U-C-H-E. From it we get the slang word bus, to kiss, and just use that at your peril. Slew, the original word, means a multitude, a host of things, or a crowd of people. It's a Gaelic word that's still often heard in areas settled by the Scots or the Scots-Irish. You always hear people say, especially at a Highland Games or some gathering of a lot of people, boy, there's a slew of people here today. That comes directly from the Gaelic. How about smidgen? Haven't you ever said when you were at the dessert table, well, I'll just have a smidgen of this and a smidgen of that and a smidgen of the other? And it means a little bit. And the world is many times carried over to anything that you just want a tiny bit from, pit, tiny bit of. Now, I was very intrigued when I learned that fried chicken had come to the South from the Isle of Skye. James Boswell from the Lowlands and his companion, England's Samuel Johnson, enjoyed roast chicken and broiled chicken in Edinburgh and London, but not until the two of them reached the Isle of Skye had they ever tasted fried fowl, as prepared by Mrs. Lachlan Mackinnon of Corrie near Broadford. The year was 1773, and in less than 10 months' time, the Mackinnons were hoping to join the hundreds of other island folk who were leaving for North Carolina. They planned to accompany Flora MacDonald, the heroine, and Flora's husband, Alan MacDonald. It happened that Mrs. Mackinnon was Alan's sister. When all of those Skye folks took their recipes with them to the Carolinas, you can be sure they took that recipe for fried chicken. Our southern biscuits are simply the scones of Scotland and Northern Ireland. I'll never forget the first time I was in Scotland. I had read about scones and read about scones, and I couldn't wait to see what they were. So the first time I was in a restaurant, I ordered some scones. And I was just absolutely astounded when they were brought to the table, and they were my grandma's biscuits exactly the same. Now, how do you cut up a chicken? Now, we don't have to cut up chickens very much anymore because they're all cut up for us in the grocery store. But when you were a child, were you shown how to cut up a chicken by your mother, your grandmother, or could be your father or grandfather? In the Highlands of Scotland, the chickens were small and scrawny sometime, and they had a whole lot of people to feed. So they jointed the chicken into 12 pieces before they fried it. But when the family, if you would go down to the Lowlands and English cooks jointed chicken, they only jointed it into 8 pieces. They had little fatter chickens, and they didn't have quite as many people to feed. And when folks reached South Carolina and North Carolina long ago, they were happy to find Southern housewives jointing their fried chicken in the old Hebridean way, that is, 12 pieces. The Gaelic language continued in use in many southern districts until the War of Northern Aggression, and even until the early 20th century in a few areas. Ministers often gave sermons in the two languages. An historical black church in North Carolina had a minister who preached in Gaelic until shortly before the First World War. And one of Gaeldom's best-loved poets, John MacRae, lived and died in the Carolinas. His songs are still known in Scotland and Nova Scotia and have been sung in Gaelic at the Grandfather Mountain Highland Games. Now then, it's time for our little bit of fun. And a Scot walks into a fish and chip shop with a fish under his arms.
"Do you have any fish cakes?"
he asked the woman frying fish. "Of course," she says.
"Oh, great,"
says the man, nodding at the fish under his arm.
"It's his birthday."
Groan, groan, groan. We love them. Join us again next time, please. I hope you enjoy it. Thank you very, very much.